And first, do silence your phones to do that. Have the education by Rep. Chuck Bevins, Papa's Lane, United Methodist, for the main stand for the best play.
Let's pray. Lord, just come before you, lifting up this city, praying for the mayor and the council and those who serve in whatever capacity, for law enforcement, for fire department, sanitation. Just lift them up to you. Pray for your hand to be upon us, your blessing, your presence. The churches. Lord, where there may be sin, give us the strength for repentance. Where there may be division, bring unity. Where there may be uncertainty, bring discernment and encouragement. Where there's doubt, bring faith. In all of this, we just ask your blessing, your full satisfaction, and your spirit to be poured out upon this city and those who lead it. All this we lift up to you in Jesus' name.
Thomas, in an effort to gain some savings here, we're looking at refinancing municipal bond. I have Brandy Latimer here to discuss the potential savings we'd have by doing this refinancing.
Good morning. We're looking at refinancing two GO bonds for potential savings of between $360,000 and $390,000, which is a 4% savings over the life of the bonds. We have Nancy Redd here that can answer questions about the refinancing.
And also Craig Pearson.
Got any questions about it? Watch Red vote. All in favor, aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number two. Authorizing all the Kenner Storms D911 locations for the sub-load.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number three, order authorizing agreement with Waste Department House of Hazardous Waste Study.
Sub-load.
Second.
Discussion?
Brother Thomas, this is an item that Mr. Smith does routinely to get rid of household hazardous waste in the city of Meridian. He's here answering questions that you may have regarding this event.
Tell us when, what, and where.
Okay, this will be a week from Saturday, September the 16th. What is Amnesty Day or Household Hazardous Waste Disposal Day? We do this every time this year. We'll have a location at the Public Works Complex and then at the Bowling Alley off Northeast Street. There again, just getting the word out as to the who, what, when, and where.
And we'll get all that out to the media, right?
Correct.
Raise the vote. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carries. Number four, order authorizing acceptance of grant award from Department of Homeland Security for fire prevention and safety. So moved.
Second.
Any questions? Concerns? Raise the vote. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number five, order authorizing the ratification of emergency agency relief plan. So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
This has to do with Clarence Chapman's locks that he's been working on for several years now. Mr. Parsons here to answer any questions you may have.
This is blighted property that we had released from the state of Mississippi. It's on 34th Avenue by 3rd Street. Ms. Houston's in your ward. And it's continuing on with the process that they're going to build the 50 new homes for the river place. And I have Mr. Kelly here to answer any questions.
Come on up, Mr. Kelly. Just to bring everybody kind of up to speed on what this project is and what our expected timeline might be.
Thank you.
Counsel.
Your tell who you are.
I'm David Kelly. I represent Charter Consulting, charter companies. Live in Brandon, Mississippi. Currently, we've just about assembled all the property that's necessary. We ran into a couple of issues when they did the environment studies. There's two that have some pretty deep holes on them and have a lot of issues, and so we're trying to replace those right now. We have had, I guess now that the rain has stopped or ceased enough, they're about to start the core drilling to make sure that we can build on all of them without doing any special foundations. That is all we were waiting on. We're working with the city on several different aspects of the how we're going to finance the gap on our. We've met with the Riley Foundation. We've met with the city. We believe we have everything together to be able to start as soon as we get our engineering information back. If nothing changes, hopefully we can start in about 60 days. So that's where we're at right now. And we will have met the reverter clause once we are able to break ground and start the grubbing and clearing. And that will be just as quick as we can get the rest of the information back from the engineering company on the soil test.
What else could happen other than drilling and turn out that you got a major problem? What else would be late?
Right now it's just that we have the tax credits are being sold to the syndicators, and there is a fund that we had to commit to, and we believe those are sold. And that was the only thing we were waiting on. And that fund will close sometime in late October, possibly in November, that fund will be closing. Mr. Chapman has four slots, which this project is one of the major slots that we have already set aside.
December, you'll start. I mean, if you've got 60 more days before you get the tax credit.
Well, assuming we don't have the kind of rain we've had, we intend to start.
Okay. Do you have any idea where your other projects across the street over here is going to happen?
Once we start these, we will mobilize on the Bell South building immediately.
Okay. We should expect by November 1st to see.
I will be back here each month giving you an update so that y'all know where we're headed. And okay. If there's any type of delays, you'll know where we're at all times. But y'all tell me when you want me to come back. I'll be glad to just come back once a month. If you've got a work session, if you want to do it then, whenever your pleasure is.
You just come the first meeting each month until we get going. It's first Tuesday at 9 a.m.
That sounds good.
Okay. Any other questions?
Thank you for continuing to try to make this thing happen. I've seen you work in other cities, and we're just, again, really, really anticipate something great happening here in the region.
So are we, because we've got about 350,000 set in the ground, we sure would like to see moving besides just setting still. So, thank you.
Thank you.
If you're on the favor, aye. Aye. Opposed, nay. Here. Number 7, we're authorized to change order number 4 with CDM Smith Inc. on the South Waste Water Treatment Plant process for chemical and lead collectors. So moved.
Second. President.
Ricky, if you could give us a little.
This has been part of the ongoing process that Director Smith has been working on. Like I said, in our agenda setting, it's a really real intricate process that Director Smith's having to go through to try to address the problems that we have at the South Waste
This morning I have with me Eric's wife, sir, with C.D.M. Smith, and he's the actual project manager in regards to the project we're talking about, and I'm going to let him address any technical questions you'll have in regards to this chamber.
My first big question, Wayne, going up $2 million. It says on here the original estimate $4,800,000, projected cost of $6,600,000. Why going up $2 million?
This goes back to the amendments we made early on in regards to the project cost going up. I think there were some change orders that were requested by Hemphill Construction that led to the $2 million change order.
We requested changes, or they requested changes.
Hemphill requested change orders in order to make the contract or the project complete.
So who screwed up on the contract and didn't put this stuff? A $2 million increase, that's a half, that's 50% increase. I don't understand why we bid projects and then we come back and say we've got to add 50% to it. Why don't we just go out and rebid it?
And you're kind of backing up, because these are conversations we had last year, in regards before we even awarded the contract. There was an original project estimate, which the design of the original contract was based on. Before we went out to bid, before we awarded the contract, the prices came in above those original estimates. Part of that was because the original design was 2 years prior to the contract being let. Some other issues with that, we also changed some of the scope of work. So in regards to that original change order you're talking about, that $2 million increase, that was in regards to the project scope somewhat changed and the timeline involved with that change. Am I correct in saying that?
That's correct. The actual increase in the amount of construction amounts to about, well, less than $200,000. I don't have an exact figure.
So from the actual project that was awarded, there's about $200,000 difference in construction costs.
Correct.
But when you look at the initial project design coupled with, like I said, the timeline and the scope of work that we actually contracted to have done, that's where that 50% change
comes from. That's my question. Why? $4,800,000 with the bid out.
We did not.
Change.
I created this problem because I put the original engineer's estimate in there and not the original bid amount.
So they underbid the project, is that what you're telling me?
They did not underbid. What he's saying is that the original, if you can follow, we did not go out to bid on a $4 million contract. That did not happen. We actually went out to bid on a $6 million contract. So in essence, there's not a 50% difference between what was actually contracted and what we're asking for in regards to a change order. And I'm going to let Eric explain that in more detail.
But the project was originally designed in 2010, 2011. At that time, the original cost estimate was prepared, and that was $4.8 million. When it was bid, in 2014, it came in, I think, just right at $6 million.
Look it up.
Yeah, and it was awarded, took a long time to award the contract, and the original time frame for getting the work done was probably a little bit unrealistic at 480 days.
And what are you saying? That's 480 days between the original design and the contract was actually awarded. We also had to go back through the SRF program to get that $6 million, you know, allotted for this project. So I want to stress, we did not award a $4 million contract from the beginning. We awarded a $6 million contract.
So this whole process started in what year,
2011 is when it initially started. Project was awarded in 2014.
Between 2011 and 2014,
the scope changed, the prices changed. Not meaning to cut y'all count, but go ahead. I hope you're following my logic and how we got it.
But the original, when we sent out for a bid, it was based. based on $6 billion anyway.
Correct. That is correct. And that, to prove that, we would have never had the money to award a $6 million contract if that had not been the original amount when we went to bid. In other words, we never would have had $6 million to award a contract.
So it wouldn't be, I'm sorry, go ahead. So it wouldn't be that because we sent out for a $6 million contract that people got wise and said, oh, I might as well add another $2 million since that's what they did for.
Correct, you're right. Because we didn't have $2 million sitting there to add to an original bid. That makes sense.
Where you get your money now?
Actually, these dollars that we're talking about in amendments is still inside the SRF loan. So these are not actual rate dollars or fund dollars. These would be dollars that would be incorporated into the SRF loan.
So we had it originally.
It was available originally.
So it's a loan.
I can't say had because it's a loan, but was it available originally? Yes.
Have we borrowed anything else against this loan?
We have not reached the capacity of the overall loan, so there's still funds available.
$6,648,839?
That's the original loan amount. What I'm saying is we have not exceeded that original loan amount in this overall project.
So the project is happening?
It is ongoing right now.
Almost finished.
Yeah. We're probably at 95%.
98%.
So what exactly are we doing today?
Let Eric talk.
We've been continuing to work in the time extension that the construction contractor had requested and received. Part of that is because of delays in delivery of materials and equipment. There are some long lead items such as turbolift blowers, which are fancy blowers, that made it impossible to get the job done in 480 days. And then a little bit of additional work that required some additional time. So we've been continuing to work past the original completion date without an amendment, and we're kind of coming to you after the fact to get the amendment. We expect that the construction project will be closed 99.9% closed out by the end of this month. So there's a limited amount of time and energy to be put into this.
To the remaining part of the project.
We're nearly there.
And just to bring the other council members up to speed, what exactly is this? What are we doing at the plant?
What we're doing is rehabilitating the process system, which includes aeration system, getting air into the wastewater to help the bugs.
Which is the life of it now, basically.
Upgrading the electrical system, which we sorely needed to upgrade, to the point where it's getting dangerous.
Dangerous, it was outdated. We were having a hard time finding replacement parts for items that would break because they were so antiquated and outdated. They were no longer available. So some of this was a necessity. Some of it was us in regards to issues we're dealing with EPA, knowing we would have to bring the plant into further compliance in regards to operation. Some of it was increasing efficiency. The blowers he mentioned are high efficiency blowers. So we took a multiple pronged approach to making these improvements. Some of it was mandated, some of it was a necessity, and some of it was us trying to make the plant more efficient.
I have no problem with the project, but I do have a problem. If somebody accepts a contract and says we will have it done within X amount of time, because of whatever reasons they can't do it in that amount of time, why is the city penalized because you can't get your supplies? That's what I don't understand. When we signed a contract, we're talking about millions of dollars. And it's delay, it's change after change. The project needs to be done. I have no problem with that. But you just said you agreed to X amount of days, you couldn't get the stuff during that time. Then don't come before us saying I can get it done in 400 days. Don't come up here telling us that if you can't do it. And that's my concern, and if it goes over that time, the city shouldn't have to suffer by delays people make billions, and they come up with time, and I know problems can occur, I know that, but the reason they get the low bid or the best bid is because they say they can do it within a certain amount of time and I can make it work. And time after time, they keep coming up here. Oh, I couldn't get this, I couldn't get that. That shouldn't be the city's problem. You do whatever it takes to get it. If you got to go get it, you go get it. Now, I'm going to vote for it. Frustrated.
Thank you, sir.
All this kind of stuff keep coming up here time after time. Did it correctly or don't accept the bid.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Ready to vote? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay.
Carried.
Number eight, order authorizing acceptance of 12-month source supply for 5,000 fittings.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried. Number nine, order authorizing reestablishment of petty cash funds for fiscal year 2018.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number 10, order authorizing charge off of inactive and uncollected 2016 water account for auditing purposes.
So moved.
Second.
Ready to vote? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number 11, ordinance authorizing garbage rate increase and water sewer rate increase.
So moved.
All right, we'll discuss that.
President Thomas, over the past 4 years, we've all been working together to look at our impending EPA consent decree. We've had multiple attorneys, multiple engineers working on this project in negotiations with the EPA and looking at what we're going to be having to deal with in the future here at the City of Meridian regarding our infrastructure. It is at their suggestion, that being our engineers, our environmental attorneys, in our opinion, that we should raise water and sewer rates to try to be proactive in coming up with the finances to address this impending problem that's going to be put on us. This is an absolute necessity, and we feel that it is necessary to move forward at this time.
Water going to be the increases.
Right, you got those areas. You get the exact numbers on the increases.
The water and sewer increases are 10% for water, 10% for sewer. So with the minimum water rate was 8.48. It is now $9.32. And that's the same amount for water and sewer.
About garbage.
Garbage, the increase is from $12 for residential to $13.71 residential. For commercial garbage, it's going from $19.80 to $22.63.
On our rate increases for our garbage, we do have a loss point there to where we're not breaking even on our garbage. And this increase will make us where we're breaking even. This residential increase of $1.71, and this increase on commercial from $19.80 to $22.63.
So your water sewer bill is going to go up 10%, your garbage bill is going to go up $1.71.
Correct.
Okay. Any other discussion? Ready to vote? All in favor, aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Next, we move to budget amendments. A, fire department changes, decrease. I'm not reading all these.
off of that, do you just shift into money around?
We're just moving money around within the budget.
You just move from capital to supplies and expenses.
Whenever you move money from capital, you have to get council, okay, so we can't, but if it's on the working side, we can do it. But if you're moving capital money, then you guys got approval.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried with the ayes, most important.
Similar to what the chief's saying, we're just moving funds inside our budget from one account to the other. One is for some cameras at Lakeview Golf Course, at the dirt pit, to monitor the material that we store out there. The other one is for some drugs and whatnot at the administration building.
So $11,200 is going to take care of cameras and the drugs and mats?
Correct. We had some funds available for cameras in the fiscal year, but not enough to cover the overall cost.
Didn't we just put some cameras up somewhere already?
We did them at the complex, not at the dirt pit. We started on milling operations, and a lot of that material is very bulky, and we need a location to store it, and we chose the dirt pit. The issue is, without any security, it would most assuredly disappear.
Who's going to be installed? Where are these cameras coming from?
Before I can let a contract, I need to have funds available for a vendor to go and install. So some of the vendors we've used in the past has been A&B Electric. There are some other security type companies that also provide cameras. Hooper's Electronics, I think, is one that does this type of work. So just to give us an example of potential vendors that could do the job.
Any other questions?
Yes,
sir.
This amendment is a transfer from the Water and Sewer Fund to the General Fund for general and administrative costs.
This is for, okay, what? That's a lot of money. What exactly are we doing here?
It's transferring money from the Water and Sewer Fund to the General Fund for general and administrative costs related to the Water Fund. So there's several employees that are paid from the General Fund, but they actually do some work, maybe 50%. 40%, 30%, that has to do with the Water Fund. So each year we do a transfer from the Water Fund to the General Fund. And this is just increasing that transfer.
So here with less than 3 weeks left in this budget, we're talking about transferring over $1 million.
Correct.
I'm not going to support that. I mean, we're going to deal with millions of dollars to do it before you get down to last 2 to 3 weeks of the budget.
Is there a shortfall? Why do we need to do this at this point with this amount of money with so little time left in this particular budget? Is there a shortfall somewhere?
In the general fund, there is a shortfall, but this is not to make up for that shortfall. This is looking at the rate that we've been transferring for over 10 years, it hasn't changed. So we went back and we did a new analysis to see how much services the Water Fund is being provided by the General Fund, that the General Fund is not recouping any money for those services.
So we went back and we redid
the analysis before with $600,000. It's been that amount for at least 10 years. So this is an increase to that amount.
Why at the end of the year, I guess I'm like Donald Thomas, why are we doing this at the end of the budget year when we're ready to start a new budget year? Wouldn't this just make more sense to do this and just with this adjustment, do it at the beginning of our next fiscal year? Why do we need to do this now, I guess is my question.
I would say that the end of the year would be a good time to do it because your using funds that are still available within your budet. So you're taking care of all the urgent needs, some of the ones within the Water Fund, and this is money that's still available in the Water Fund. Appropriations that are still available in the Water Fund that we can transfer.
So if we transfer this money, then whatever's left, we're gonna then turn around and put it in our reserve?
Correct.
So what is this money gonna be used for?
It's used as a reimbursement, so it's additional revenue to the general fund. So you're reimbursing the general fund for the expenses that the general fund has paid for the water fund.
Like what?
Like salaries for people who go out and inspect the water lines that may work in the, that may work in the public works side of the budget. You have people in financial records that deal with water and sewer issues with customers, that are actually paid from the general fund. So their full-time job is working on the water fund, they are working a portion of the time.
But have those salaries already been paid?
They've been paid by the general fund, but some of it is the water fund's responsibility.
So if we approve this, then our general fund is probably, like I said, gonna be over, and then that money will then be transferred to our reserve, which I think our audit showed this year that we had to use a lot of our reserve money.
We used a portion of the reserve, yes.
This year.
This year.
So since these salaries have already been paid, then we should have carryover in addition to what's already been proposed in the budget. Since you can't go back, you don't go forward, we should have a carryover in excess of $2 million in the incoming budget. We already have 800 some thousand in there. We add 1.2 million to it. I mean, the salaries already been paid, the workers been paid, the expenses have been paid, everything's been paid. So we should have a carryover of approximately $2 million in the next year's budget. Is that correct?
I can't say what it would be because those are not the only expenses in the general fund. So there are still additional expenses in all the seven departments of the general fund.
I would like an itemized list of what those are if I'm going to consider transferring this amount of money at this end of the year. We're talking about salaries, we're talking about expenses like that, that evidently were not put in the budget last year. If you have to do it right now, I'm all concerned about the legal aspect. Attorney can speak on that. At this point in the year, transferring that amount of money to cover expenses and salaries that have already been paid. And now you're saying, well, it's already been paid, but now we'll go back and get this money to reimburse. But if you reimburse, then all this money ought to be carried over money. Because we should have, if you're going to reimburse the general fund, then you've got a balance left in the general fund that we can carry forward. Maybe. I'm just out of here. Plus, this late in the year, making these kind of changes, I'm concerned about the legal aspects of it. So there are, I have a lot of questions which I've expressed before.
Mr.
That's
Attorney.
Why I'm not going to vote for this.
Mr.
Attorney, what do you think?
I have the same issues early on. I said I was going to a couple of weeks ago.
Two quick items. One, good morning, Council.
Morning.
Our Nickelodeon Day of Play will be this Saturday from 10 to 2 at Highland Park. We're going to have face painting, bouncers, water slides, food, basketball, splash pad, and a bunch of giveaway prizes. So So please come out and enjoy Nickelodeon Day of Play at Highland Park this Saturday from 10 to 2. Also, Meridian High's football game this week will be Saturday night at 6 and not on Friday night at 5. Highland Day of Play is September 16th. Unfortunately, Ricky, I told him it was this Saturday.
He's anxious.
He is anxious. Stays anxious. At any rate, but the football game for the Meridian High School is this Saturday at 6 and not on Friday night. One last thing, guys, as you know, as we continue to move forward with the upgrades of water, sewer, and a lot of things that we're working on now have been items that go back two or three administrations. We meet with EPA on September, I think, the 26th of this month, and hopefully we can get some closure on the items that they have discussed with us over the last 2.5 years. We also will be moving forward with some items to improve our water sewer collections with installation of new water meters that we want to bring to you guys over the next 2 weeks. We have a plan to go forward with that so that we properly charge our citizens the correct rate and we properly get the return from those water rates and also our electrical efficiencies in all of our city buildings. So we will be moving forward with that in the next 2 weeks. But I just wanted to give you some information as it relates to EPA and also give the community some information as it relates to why we're doing some of the things that we have to do. We have a lot of outdated systems and outdated structures, and the can has been kicked up the road for 15 to 20 years, and now it's up to this council and this mayor to do the things that we need to do so that we can be more efficient and we can upgrade our systems throughout the city. So that's all I have. Thank you very much.
All right, move to citizens' comments. Be limited to 3 minutes. Please address your comments to council as a whole. First, Mr. Abbott, shoot.
Good morning.
Morning. Good morning.
Can y'all hear me good? Oh, sorry. Anyway, I'm going to repeat what I said during the last meeting. I'm here to say it again. We need to get this meeting put on the web page. We pay $36,000 a year for that web page. It should work for us, citizens. We need to get more Portuguese on. What's on that web page right now? You find your local phone book. Yeah. So why are we paying $36,000 for something we can't use? And I'll be here 2 more weeks to remind you again. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you. Pat Norris. Pat Norris here. Pat Norris. Final call.
Good morning.
Good morning
to the mayor, city council. Thank you all for allowing me to speak today. I'm speaking on behalf of the Martin Luther King Celebration Committee and Parade. For the last 20 years, we brought our parade and all the activities for the Martin Luther King Parade to our city of Meridian, to the pride and all the things that comes with the parade, to have people come out, celebrate, and also it also brings revenue to our city. The hotels, the restaurants, the grocery stores, people plan their vacation trip or whatever around the Martin Luther King Parade because it's a pretty big event. It's a well-planned event. And we just want to thank the city for over the last 20 years for supporting us and being a part of it. But this year, we're looking for bigger and better things. We're asking the city for $15,000. And what happens is we bring several university bands, at least we try to, if we can get to them in time before they go somewhere else. We also, in the last few years, we've asked high school bands to come and participate. And we feel like that boosts the morale for the students, the kids, the schools, and also for our young people in the community. So I just want to thank you all for supporting us, supporting that event, and I look forward to working with you all in the future. And I want to thank you all very much.
As you David said, do you have information today?
Yes, I do have. I don't have the theme yet, but working on that. but the date for the parade is January 15th, and it's usually always on a Monday. And I also want to pitch our gala, our scholarship gala, which is a little different from the parade, but that's our biggest fundraiser of the year. And we usually have 200 to 300 people at our gala, and we have raised money for scholarships. And we awarded 5 scholarships in this auditorium within the last month. So I just want to thank you all for allowing us to do what we do. Thank you. Any more questions?
When will you get to know about your signing request?
Yesterday. No, I'm just kidding. As soon as possible. Thank you. As soon as possible. We're in our planning stages, and as you know, in any business, when you're planning, you set your budget, and you know what you can do within that budget.
What's your total budget?
Our total budget is $15,000.
So you have to give within your budget?
Pardon me?
So you have to give within your budget?
We try to.
What we just discussed was.
We try to.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next, Dennis R. Allen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have with me Brother Sam. Bill, he's next. But we both eventually got the same thing.
Okay, that's good.
So if you don't mind, I'll run a little bit. I'm on his time.
Don't take his time.
Okay. You see, I only got 3 minutes.
You all.
I'm here basically this morning concerning the Confederate banner and the flying Mississippi flag. As you all probably know, around the state, they've been taken down. And right here in Meridian, we have it in the courtrooms. And we always say that we want slavery to be a thing of the past. We should move forward. I can't agree more. But when I walk in the courtroom, that's the first thing come. It gets my attention. If we want to go on toward the future, we must go ahead and Riverside past. What I'm saying is, their flag symbolizes hate, oppression. And this will be a country of democracy when we come together. It divided us as a whole. Now God's showing us a sign with all these storms coming. And to be practically honest, he's still out there on the water now waiting. Now, I don't know if y'all know the history of a hurricane, but it starts on the west coast of Africa. And it comes with that same little package as the slave trade. To me, it's my spirits or my ancestors giving us a sign. Now, I'm not a person of hate. I'm pro-black, but I'm not anti-white. Because anybody know me personally, tell you, I get along with anybody. And I love everybody. I don't have no hatred in my heart. I wasn't raised that way. But I want us to come together September 11th. The reason why that's significant, September 11th, called Desiccated American Hate, all over television, all over the world. That same thing is brewing right now in this country again. September 11th is a significant date because it's important to us as a country. A lot of people probably say, well, we shouldn't do it on that day. It's disrespectful. Well, I'll be disrespectful for that flag to be flying down there on the court hall lawn on public property. It needs to be taken down. Now, if anybody wants it on their personal property, that's fine with me. Because we all have that right. But I don't want to pay for it because I'm a taxpayer. I would pay for it. I had to see my brother and sister go in the courtroom and suffer over the years, getting thrown away like nothing. Because we all know there's a double standard in the law still to this day. They still use the black code and all that time. I don't want to rush over. I get kind of emotional about this because it's dealing my heart because I've seen a whole lot of this go on hatred in this time. It's time for us to come together. September 11th at 10 a.m. that morning, we'll be at the Lauderdale County Courthouse. And I want y'all to be translucent on this issue with the citizens of this town. We want to know where y'all stand. And we'll know that they, if y'all be there with us. If we're going to be against hatred.
Then we're out of time.
Good Lord. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Take it on, brother.
Good morning, brother and sister.
Good morning.
To the mayor and city council and citizen Richard, I'm Brother Sam Bell, street actor. I host a radio talk show on WN 12:09 a.m., the bell ringer. And like the brother was saying about the Confederate flag, other cities in Mississippi are removing the flags, trying to get rid of the past history. Because we understand that a little young brother in Charlotteville, South Carolina, he displayed his flag all over the internet, anything, everything. So what we ask the city council and the mayor to remove this Confederate flag off state property in Meridian. I'm going to give you some examples. And we know that the Confederate flag is optional. It's not mandatory. Optional means we have a choice here if we want to fly the flag or not. We understand the flag offends a lot of people. Some, they want to say it's their heritage. But if you study history, it ain't about heritage. It's about hate. Clark Dale, Mississippi, Judge Carlos Moore, he removed the Confederate flag out of his courtroom. Renee City Council, they voted 4-3 to remove the flag off state property. Greenwood, Mississippi voted 6-1 to remove the Confederate flag off city property. John Manning, President and CEO of Oxford County, Chamber of Commerce. This is what this brother said. Economic developers statewide are having a very, very difficult time of selling Mississippi due to stereotype out there. Their perception that difficult to overcome. We're taking it down to create and flood new jobs. So a lot of people want to come to Mississippi with jobs, but they see so much hatred in Mississippi, and one of the representatives of Mississippi is the Confederate flag. So like the brother was saying, what we asked is to remove the Confederate flag off state property in Meridian, Mississippi, where we pay our taxpayer. Because when young brothers go in the judge chamber and have to face time, and we have to look at that flag right there. So we ask y'all, will you please remove the flag? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, now we have the council comments.
All right, well, thank you, Mr. Sam Bell and Mr. Allen, for coming today and raising awareness for this important issue. I've said in interviews before that I do believe it's time to change the state flag. Anytime you have a large percentage of the population that feels as if it's a reminder of slavery and other horrible things from our past, I think it's just right that we take action to change and remove that flag. But looking ahead, as it's about time, I think, to start preparing for like a legislative lobbying agenda, I had the opportunity, thanks to Twitter, to communicate with some people at MML who assured me that their number one priority is that our legislators understand that we think municipalities should get a larger share of sales tax. I think that's something most of us can agree on. So now we got to make sure that our representatives who go to Jackson also understand that, so that we can get a larger share of that. Furthermore, to address Mr. Shute's comments that we routinely hear, I also heard from a constituent that it would be a good idea if we live streamed our meetings on Facebook. It's pretty simple. You have a smartphone or an iPad or whatever, you can just set it up here and stream the whole thing on Facebook. So that'd be pretty simple to take care of our issue and provide more access to people. So transparency is a good thing. And then lastly, I don't have a date yet. I'm looking at holding a community meeting in October, similar to what Councilwoman Houston and Manny Johnson also did. Maybe Tyrone wanted to do something unusual, we could do something like that. Yeah, discuss this show.
Good morning, everybody. We thank you all for coming out, and thank all of our citizens who participated and take advantage of the time and bring stuff to our attention. I want to thank the mayor and all the department heads that came out to our community meeting that we had last month. We've had some weeks between our council meetings, but we thank the community for all of the questions, and hopefully the administration is addressing all of those concerns and making sure that everybody is well pleased. I want to thank Ms. Johnson for allowing us to come over to the club that's in her ward to host that event that we did together. It was a great turnout. We want to encourage the citizens when they do set these meetings up, when we set these meetings up, please attend them, because it's your opportunity to have basically an open mic to let your voice be heard and to address those issues that's going on in your neighborhood. We take notes, we write names, we get phone numbers, and then we take action. So it is very important that our citizens come out and be a part of that. School is back in session, so as always, we want to encourage the community to volunteer. I know there's a group, and I reposted it on my Facebook page. I believe it's the Meridian Star that has this initiative about reading, and they're trying to get volunteers to fill every single classroom to read on this particular day. I thought I had that information handy, but it is on my Facebook wall if you want to participate in that. We need volunteers to show up and read. It's just one day, but we're trying to show the people in the community and our students that we do care about them. And I know several of you had made mention about we're going through the agenda real quickly. Our council president doesn't like to waste a lot of time, but any of you that council members, if you do have questions or need the CAO to stop and explain something, we can do that, or y'all can just see us, for the citizens can see us after the meeting. We'll be glad to address or answer any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Just want to say thank you for everybody that came out. The meeting we had, the community meeting, went really well. We actually had a phone call a couple days later with a compliment that something she had asked for got done in 2 or 3 days. And that was a welcome surprise, considering we usually don't get compliments. So thanks to everybody who come out and continue to support us and continue to give us the opportunity to support you.
Good evening. Reiterating on what Ms. Kim said, I think that literature day, I think it's Friday. I know it might be, it's from 9 to 11 in the morning. So if you guys want to come out and have read to the students, that'd be awesome. Cemetery, Elmwood Cemetery. We had a lot of people came out and showed support. We had a lot of things done on August the 19th. And since then, a lot of families got a chance to actually come out there and visit their loved ones who they had not seen in years. So it's been a humble experience to see that. We were going to return out there this Saturday at 8 o'clock. So it's going to be this Saturday at 8 o'clock, September 9th at 8 o'clock, from 8 to 12. And we asking everyone to come out and try to show your support. We need lawnmowers. You know, we got caught up with a lot of vines out there, so it slowed down some process. But we need your help to try to get this help, because there's a lot more room out there that, you know, the grass that tall as you, and you cannot see your family, or people cannot see their family. Mr. Bunky, after this, if you don't mind if I can meet with you, I have a citizen here, and he's trying to get his home. He want to rebuild his home, tear it down, rebuild it. We got a couple of issues on COVID that he want to talk to you about. And again, thank you guys for bringing up the issue with the Confederate flag. It has been an issue throughout the country. But, yeah, thank you.
What cemetery?
Elmwood Cemetery. It's on 10th Avenue and 24th Street. It's on the corner.
Special thanks to Olive Garden for providing meals to first responders. They took it upon themselves to provide meals the last few days, maybe yesterday, whatever day it was. But they, on their own, decided to provide that to first responders throughout the city. They didn't have to do that. It's a great thing that they do recognize those guys and gals that are out there every day. The Riley Center and MCC have both announced their programs for this year. I encourage people to support those. Excellent programs that are there. Schools starting. Kim's always talking about schools. That's extremely important that we get out and support these youngsters. We still have too many children that leave school or don't take advantage of what the offerings are out there. Flood victims, we've been blessed to the extent that we didn't have to suffer the tragedy those folks have suffered out in Texas and Louisiana, and what's coming toward Florida, perhaps toward us also in the next week or so. Those folks need help. They need money. Money goes a long way. Goods and things like that, a lot of things they can't even buy now because the stores are closed. September 12th is a budget hearing. If you have questions about the budget, you need to contact us, let us know. I think that was in the release to the media last week. If you have you have questions about that, just let us know. If council members have questions about agenda items, we're welcome to discuss all we want to discuss. Just speak up, let me know. Nothing else, we adjourn.
Legend, Randy, 5 o'clock.